Welcome to this session on the beginning of the third adhyaya of Sri Bhagavad Gita. This adhyaya is the Karma Yoga. It's vistara, it's more detailed description. Let us start with the gratitude to the Lord, with whose grace all this is possible, and the Guru Parampara through which this knowledge has been protected since many generations. I would like to bow down to our Pujya Guruma, with whose grace I am able to learn these scriptures and pass on my understanding, share my understanding with you all. Let us start with a prayer. Om Sahana Vavatu Sahana Vunaktu Sahaviryam Karvavahai Tejasvinavaditamastu Ma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. So the third adhyaya is Karma Yoga and is one of the most important adhyayas of the Bhagavad Gita, because we are all in the Karma Yoga, and that's why it is important to learn how to do karma. We have all been taught since childhood that we should work hard, we should do our job well, we should do our studies well, we should do our work well. But what is the way we should do it? What is that attitude behind the work, or what is that way of doing the work that will help us to improve on ourselves, to better the tasks that we do, to do it more efficiently, to do it more precisely, to do it more skillfully, to do it more efficiently? And this is what Karma Yoga teaches us. So before we go to the Karma Yoga, let us recapitulate the second adhyaya, because there is a link between all the adhyayas of Sri Bhagavad Gita, and we should also understand this link. In the first 10 shlokas, Arjuna's condition is described. He is stuck with Karpanya Dosha Pahata Swabhavaha, and he asks Krishna to give him what is Shreya for him, what is the best advice for him. He accepts his Shishyatva or his disciplehood. In the 7th shloka, Shishyastveham Shadimam Dvam Prapannam accepts, surrenders to the Lord, that show me the path, I'm stuck with sorrow, grief, I don't know what to do, whether I should fight, whether I should run away, whether I should not fight. And then from the 11th shloka, Shri Krishna starts his teaching to Arjuna, initially about the Atmajnana, the Brahma Vidya, which is the ultimate goal of human existence, and then which is also the sar or the summary of the Upanishads. And after that he talks about the Dharma Upadesha according to Dharma. Kshatriya Dharma is for Arjuna, what is best for him according to his own understanding, what is good, what he should do. Even if he believes that this body is the one that is born and it dies, even then he should fight the war. So all this happens. So it is all about the jnana or the knowledge part of the second adhyaya. That's why it is also called Sankhya Yoga, because this is the central message of the second adhyaya. After this Swadharma and Kartavya Upadesha, there is a twist, and Shri Krishna talks about Esha Te Bhita Sankhya. I am going to talk now about Samadukhe Sukham Dhiram Somrutatvaya Kalpate. He changes the topic and goes to Karma Yoga. And then after the link shlokas to Karma Yoga, the main Karma Yoga principle, the 47th shloka, Karmanye Vadikaraste Mahafaleshu Kadachana, and Yogastha Kuru Karmani Sangam Tyaktva Dhananjaya Samatvam Yoga Uchyate. So all these important principles have been described. And finally, the last part of the second adhyaya, as you remember, the last 18 shlokas is the Sita Prajna Prakarana, or the subdivision of the Sita Prajna Mahapurusha, who is the person who is learned, who is the seer, who is already enlightened, who has already obtained that knowledge, is at the peak of his climax of his human existence, where he how does he sit, how does he walk, how does he behave, how does he interact with the world. And in this, Shri Krishna talks about Indriya Sanyam, Yada Samharate Chayam Kurmongani Sarvashah, how, you know, one should act like a turtle, withdraw all our sense organs, Indriya Sanyam, and talks about a lot of other aspects. And finally, in the 72nd shloka, talks about the Esha Brahmi Sthiti Partha Nainam Prapya Vimuyati, and talks about moksha, mukti, what is the final destination, the salvation, the freedom from all these miseries, grief, sorrow. How is that possible? What is that with which it is possible? He says, it's by understanding our own self, our own knowledge of ourself, that takes care of the ignorance, which, you know, which goes away, and along with this, we can attain this state. So this is in a nutshell the second adhyaya, and the third adhyaya is the description in more details of Karma Yoga. What is Karma Yoga? How it can be practiced? What are the attitudes of Karma Yoga? And what is actually Karma Yoga? So it's a very beautiful adhyaya, which helps us in our day-to-day life to learn to make it useful in our day-to-day life. So let us start with the introduction of the Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga is the first step in the spiritual journey. Even after Shri Krishna spoke about the climax, he started with the Karma Yoga. So Karma Yoga also, it signifies that it is the first step in the spiritual journey, because in the spiritual journey, the first step is to get rid of our impurities of our mind. You know, the raga, the dvesha, the kama, krodha, the moha, mad, matsarya, all these impurities, kashmala, which is in our mind, the durguna, or the asuri sampatti, as we call it. This have to be first cleansed. So cleansing of our inner mind, purification of our mind is the first step of the spiritual sadhana. And this is essentially what Karma Yoga does. So Karma Yoga is a very important sadhana. It is also called the Yoga, Karma Yoga, because it's one of the ways to unite with the Lord. When Lord says Yoga, Yoga Marg is the way to unite to the Supreme. You know, he has already shown what is the ultimate goal of the human existence, Brahma Vidya, Brahma Vidyayam, and Yoga Shastra. So Brahma Vidya is the theory part, the knowledge part, which we need to attain to understand. And how we can do this, that is the Yoga Marg. So Yoga Marg is the practical mark, or the practical way we can reach to this understanding. And there are several ways, you know, karma, bhakti, jnana, ashtanga yoga, dhyana, all these are different aspects of leading to our ultimate supreme, our divinity, that is what we are pervaded with. So this is how the Karma Yoga is more important. And Lord Krishna also tells us that karma gati gahana gati means that the karma, it is very difficult to understand. It's not that easy to understand karma, because it has a very deep meaning, and that's why there is a need to have a guru in our life, so that guru can help us understand. A learned teacher who has learned all the Upanishads would be the right person to tell us about Karma Yoga, to give a right perspective to us. What is the, you know, role of Karma Yoga in our life? What is the, you know, how it begins, and what is the end? What is the limit of Karma Yoga? What is the importance of karma versus jnana? What are the other ways we can inculcate with karma? How can we do it well? All these understanding can only be given by a learned guru. And that's why this guru parampara, the self-knowledge, how this Brahma Vidya is protected, Atma Jnana is protected, is very important. Karma is done by everyone, and as we understand karma, as we understand it, it is more like a physical action, and we all are involved. Everything, every atom in the universe is involved in karma. Karma essentially means, you know, to do something, some kind of motion is karma. So we are all in everything, and the entire universe is in motion. All the creatures are constantly in motion. Even human beings, we are always occupied in some or the other activity. So that is karma, action, motion. However, karma is not synonymous with Karma Yoga. And I'm sure most of us know that Karma Yoga is quite different than karma. So when we say somebody is doing very good work or very good karma, it does not mean that he is doing karma yoga. Karma yoga is done by only very few people. It is a very, very, you know, a very kind of an elevated position, you know, from the perspective of the spiritual aspect, that it because it has the power to liberate us from this bondage of karma. It is said that karma itself is karma yoga is one of the main tools for our upliftment, for our spiritual upliftment. And it is said that the actions, the karma itself is just swabhav hai unka, karma ka. The nature of karma is to bind, because it, you know, the moment we do karma, we obtain some phala, the action, the results or the fruits, and then sometimes we like that, so that there is a raga vritti, or we don't like it, there is a dvesha vritti, and this binds us to karma. So that when we like something, then we want to do it again and again to produce the same result or even better result. That is called satashaitva, means we want to improve our result. So this is the endeavor that we all are involved in all the time. You know, we want to do well, we want to work in our own chosen field of interest, and we want to do it better and better to improve and improve. So this is the nature of karma. And sometimes we keep doing it all our life without understanding what is happening to this karma, how it is causing bondage, how can we get relieved from this karma. Now the best news is that the bondage of the karma that it produces can also be relieved by karma. So karma not only causes bondage, but if you do karma in a different way, then it can release you from the bondage. Essentially means one is going round and round around the rope is keeping on binding us, right? What we need to do is to understand that this is causing bondage. We have to keep moving, but start moving in the opposite direction. We have to change the course. It's not that we have to change our movement or the motion or the karma. We have to continue moving, we have to continue our action, but with a different understanding, with a different attitude, and then we are released from this bondage, from this rope which is tightening around us. We can release ourselves from this and can lead us to freedom. So what is this? So it is said that kaate se hi kaate ko nikalna hai. Matlab, if we are pricked by a thorn, then also we remove that thorn with another thorn, like a needle. We use the needle to remove the thorn, right? So similarly, it is only with karma that we have to release the bondage of karma. And that is the skill of karma yoga. That is the skill that we need to learn. That is what Lord Shri Krishna talks to us in the third adhyaya. So what is that karma yoga? Now let us come to what is karma yoga. According to one of the shlokas of the 49th shloka of the second adhyaya, yoga karma su kaushalam, the skill in action and its results is karma yoga. That is what he said. In 48th shloka, Shri Krishna says, samatvam yoga uchyate. Samatva is yoga. Samatva buddhi is yoga buddhi. And in 49th he says, yoga karma su kaushala. So skill in action and its results is karma yoga. Now, let us understand that whatever work we are doing, whatever is our, you know, roles and responsibilities in our life, you know, be it we are parents, we are, you know, children, we are student, we are a teacher, we are worker, what is our job, you know, we may in a profession or we are employed. And we have different roles in our life, and whenever we are doing those roles, we are practicing our karma or we are doing our karma. Now, when we switch from karma to karma yoga, we don't have to change what we are doing. Essentially, it is very important to understand that we don't have to change our actions. Our actions or our karma will remain the same. Karma to karma yoga does not mean that we start doing something else. We are doing our profession, our business, and we just leave it and then go to social service or do some donations. So that is not karma yoga. Karma yoga is a very different attitude. We'll come to that what it is. But essentially, it is important to understand that practicing karma yoga does not mean that we have to leave our existing karma or our existing actions or our activity. The sphere of activity, our activity or our work will remain essentially the same. But what we need to change is the attitude behind which we do this karma. That is what is karma yoga. Now it's very interesting, because karma yoga essentially for us means, karma yoga means that we must do something physically. Because for us, mortals' understanding of karma means only physical action. But in the grand vision of the Vedas, the Upanishads and Bhagavad Gita, karma is not just physical. Any motion is karma. Means even a thought is a karma. Even a talk, a speech, a word itself is a karma. So kaika, that is a physical, manasika, mental, the thoughts, the thinking pattern, and the vachika, the speech. Everything is karma according to our scriptures. So essentially, karma yoga is a much more sukshma or a more subtle part of doing the karma. And that is our attitude, which is behind our action. So we don't have to change our action. What we need to do is change our attitude. So that is what is karma yoga. It's a very profound understanding, because we don't have to change our actions. We don't have to change our physical actions. What we have to do is, you know, use our intellect. Buddhi yoga dhananjaya. So buddhi, a yoga, or with our buddhi we have to practice, with our intellect we have to use, and then we have to, with understanding we have to do karma, and we have to, how, what is that attitude, we will come to that. But essentially, firstly, we have to understand that we don't have to change our karma. What we need to change is the attitude behind this karma. And this attitude is towards two parts. One is the karma, or the actions that we do, and second is the karma phala. Karma phala means the fruits of the action, or the results, or the outcomes of the actions that are produced when we do that karma. So this attitude towards both this, the karma part and the karma phala part, is both are important, and there are different attitudes for both this. We will come to that. So let us start with the first shloka of the third adhyaya. It opens with Arjuna, who starts with a question. Shri Krishna, Arjuna uvacha, jayasi chet karmanaste, mata buddhir janatana, tatkim karmani ghore maam, niyojayasi keshava. So this Arjuna's question is a very welcome question. Actually, the way Upanishads and is being taught, you know, questions are always welcome. There is always the method is a lot of Upanishads have been, you know, are based on question and answer. Like there is an Upanishad called Prashna Upanishad, which is based on question and answer. Similarly, there are many other Upanishads where there is a question and answer format. So questions are very welcome. Though on one side it says that, you know, you have faith, Shraddhavan Labhate Jnanam, but on the other side, our Upanishads, our scriptures tell us that, you know, you have an inquiry, and you know, don't just believe what is being said. You have to first question, understand, then question, then again receive an answer from the Guru, and then again try to resolve, do self-inquiry. Again, you know, if there is clarity, if not, then again ask the question, again get a clarification, and we must clarify all our doubts. So that is a fundamental thing of our Upanishads. Though there is a difference, you know, Vedas, as you know, is divided into two parts, the karma kand and the jnana kand. The karma kand is the initial part, or the almost 80% part of the Veda, which is more on the karma, the yagnas and the vidhi vishesh. So a lot of vidhis have been described, that if you do this, you'll get this. These are some of the vidhis, or some of the, you know, kind of yagnas that are described. Here questions are not welcome, because there is a particular way of doing the vidhi, and that somebody say, for example, you have to take akshmani for 3 times. It is written in the vidhi, then you don't ask questions, why not 4 times, why not 5 times. So their question is not much welcome. But the jnana kand, or the last part, the knowledge part of the Vedas, which are the Upanishads, where there is a description of our own atma jnana, our own self knowledge, here is where a method of inquiry, questions, is very welcome. And this Arjuna's question is also a very thoughtful question, because he asks, O Janardana, one who destroys the wicked people, that is the name of Shri Krishna. He says, Chetya mata karmanaha buddhihi jayasi. If according to you, knowledge is superior to actions, tat Keshava, then O Lord Keshava. Keshava is another name for Shri Krishna. It also means the Lord of the senses, and the one who takes care of all the kleshas. And it is also the amalgamation of the Trinity, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. So these are the meanings of word Keshava. माम कर्मणि घोरे किम नियोजयसि, व्हाई डू यू पुश मी इनटू दिस ग्रूसम बैटल, ही सेज। सो बेसिकली Arjuna has listened to the second adhyaya very intently. He knows that initially God Lord talked about jnana, then he spoke about karma yoga, and finally talked about sthita prajna, the climax or the ultimate position of the jnana purusha, where he can reach. And so he is confused whether karma is great, better, or jnana is better. And probably he thinks that Lord Krishna started with jnana and ended with jnana, in between there was karma. So obviously, according to Lord Krishna, the jnana or the knowledge is the supreme. That's what he thinks. And then he now thinks that though knowledge is supreme, why does always Lord Krishna ask me, Tato Uttishta Bharata, Yuddha Kruta Nishchaya, you have to fight this war. He always keeps on telling Arjuna to fight this war. So then he's asking Krishna, it's a very beautiful question. He says, if according to you knowledge, the jnana, self-knowledge is superior, then why do I need to fight this war? Why did I not go to the forest, do some sadhana, do some meditation and obtain this atma jnana? That is the question. And it's a very beautiful, very thoughtful question. Obviously, it shows that there is a confusion in the mind of Arjuna, and that is why he is a candidate for this kind of understanding. If we would have understood the Atma Jnana in the second Adhyaya, Guruji tells us that, you know, Gitaji would not have happened the next from the third Adhyaya onwards. But because Arjuna is not able to grasp, probably because he is in a rage of sorrow and emotion state, where these kind of Atma Jnana may be not easy to digest. And that's why he asks this confusion, and this confusion persists till the beginning of the sixth Adhyaya, where Lord Krishna gives him one message that what is the better path and when one should go for each path. So this question, innocent question, shows Arjuna's simplicity, his saralta, his acceptance that he is confused, he is not clear, he wants to know, and that is what is important for a seeker, for someone like us who is just initiated on this path. We need to be simple to ask for whatever we are not knowing or whatever we want to know, and express our confusion to our Guruji. Vyamishreneva vakyena buddhim mohayasiva me tadekam vadanishchitya yena shreyoham apnuyam. So in the second shloka, Arjuna says, with these conflicting or mixed words, you are as if deluding my mind. Moha yasiva me. There is some moha which is creating, I'm getting confused, I'm not clear with these mixed words. You know, you have chosen some mixed words. You are seeing on one side jnana is superior, on one side you say karma yoga is superior. So tell me one clear message. Tat ekam vada nishchitya. Out of all these two options, please, Shri Krishna, tell me one thing that I need to do, whether I need to go and fight this war, or I need to obtain the Atma Jnana and become wise like a Sthita Prajna. Yena aham apnuyam shreyaha, with which I can attain this Supreme Self, the Shreya. Shreya path is the good or the betterment of our upliftment, which is the most beneficial for us. So it is said that out of the four Purusharthas, Dharma, Artha, Kama, the first three are the Preya Purushartha, Preya. Dharma, Artha and Kama, they all keep us in this world. But if you want to transcend and go to the, you know, to the supreme, the blissful, the spiritual, the world, Nestrai Gunyo Bhavarjuna, that is the Shreya Purushartha. So Shreya is the Kalyan. Kalyan is the betterment, the good, the best thing for a human being to attain the Supreme Self, Moksha. That is the Shreya Purushartha. So he says, why don't you tell me what is Shreya for me, what I should attain? What is most beneficial for me, whether karma will lead me to the moksha or whether jnana will lead me to the moksha, please tell me, I am confused. So with this, Arjuna asks for one solution which is born out of his confusion of the two. And what does Lord answer? Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Lokesmin Dvividha Nishtha Pura Prokta Mayanagha Jnana Yogena Sankhyanam Karma Yogena Yoginam. So Shri Krishna is still confusing Arjuna, looks like, because he's showing him two paths and not giving him one answer. He says there are two paths to this salvation and you have to decide what is best for you based on your inclination, your liking and based on your attitude. He says, O Anaga Arjuna, and Anaga means Nishpapa, who has not done any sin. He is just trying to console Arjuna that whatever your situation is, it is okay. It's not out of the sin that you have any sins that you have committed. O Anaga Arjuna. This says, Asmin Loke Duvidha Anishta Maya Pura Prokta, means for humans, two types of different determined lifestyle approaches have been described by me. And this Pura Prokta means this has been done quite earlier, ancient times. Just when I created the universe, when the Vedas were created, that was the time that I have already said that there are two paths how to reach me, you know. And Pura Prokta could also mean earlier, you know. That means that in second adhyaya, I have already said that these are the two approaches. There is the two lifestyle approaches. One is the Jnana Marg, one is the Karma Marg. So he says here also, he says, Sankhyanam Jnana Yogena, for the knowledge seeking yogis, it is the path of knowledge, the Jnana Yoga. This is for the renunciates, you know, for those who are the yogis. There is a path of knowledge, the Jnana Yoga. And Yoginama Karma Yogena. Karma Yogena Yoginam means for the action oriented people, it is the path of action, the Karma Yoga. And for most of us, almost 99% of us who are all in the karma, in the sansara, in the world, all occupied in our day-to-day activities, karma path is the path of choice. We will come to that, whether what Lord Krishna says and how he tells us which path is better. But here he is not giving one answer and he says, according to your suitability, you have to choose whether you want to take the Jnana Marga or the Karma Marga. For the knowledge seeking yogis, it is the Jnana Yoga, which is the better path. For the Karma Yoga, you know, people who are action oriented, for whom they cannot sit without doing work, and most of the people are like that, they cannot sit without working, for them Karma Yoga is the path to this Shreya Purushartha or Mukti. So let us understand what Shri Krishna tries to say here. Most of us who are in our work karma and dedicated to our work karma nishtha, though this is not considered to be the spiritual journey, this is our material journey that we carry on and continue in our life. But there are some people who start developing a vivek, and you know, some questions come up in the mind, and they want to understand something that is beyond what is seen in the world. What is that adhishtana or the foundation of this universe? What is it that there is some understanding beyond what our mind and our eyes can decipher? And for these people, they embark on this journey. It is called the sadhana. And this sadhana, the Lord says here, there are two paths to this sadhana. One is the Karma Yoga and one is the Jnana Yoga. Both of these are nishtha. Nishtha means determined approaches, lifestyle approaches. So it could be a Karma Yoga nishtha or it could be a Jnana Yoga nishtha. And for most of us who are action oriented, who are in the world, who are involved in activity, the Karma Yoga nishtha is the path. But only for a very few people who are yoganishtha, who are renunciates, who have already achieved from the world, who doesn't want anything, don't have that desires to achieve anything from the world, then Jnana Yoga nishtha could be a good path, especially if they have already had the purity of their antakarana or mind. No? But Karma Yoga nishtha, for most of the people, Karma Yoga nishtha is the starting point of this spiritual journey, the sadhana. And you can see here that the Karma Yoga nishtha leads to Shuddhi, and that the second path is the Jnana Yoga nishtha. So it's basically continuation of the path. Essentially, there are no two separate paths. Both the paths, they continue, because from Karma Yoga, after one has achieved what one has to achieve from Karma Yoga, we'll obviously go to the Jnana Yoga, and finally, we need to do that Jnana Sadhana also to achieve that Jnana or the Atma Jnana, the self-knowledge. So this Jnana Sadhana is also important, and then we have to achieve the Sadhya or the Jnana, the Brahma Jnana, Atma Jnana or the self-knowledge. This is to be achieved. So this is what Lord Krishna tells here, that there are two paths, and both these paths one has to choose according to their inclination, liking, which one is better. So let us understand still further. A person who is working, who is already doing his work, is called a karmi. He is not called a karma yogi. So what is the difference between karmi and karma yogi? Let us see. So karmi is the people, most of us, like, who are involved in our sakam karma. Sakam karma is an action which starts with the desire and which ends with the desire. So there is always the desire is the center, that if I do this, what am I going to get? So my mind is already fixed on the outcome, the results, and my attachment is already fixed there. And whenever I receive that result, I'll probably see whether it is good or it is bad, it is adequate, it is inadequate, whether it is as per my expectation, lesser or more. And based on that, we have sanskaras, raga, dvesha, which again force us or pravrutta karte humko to do more and more karmas. And then we continue doing this chakra, and that is called the sansara chakra. We keep doing this, is a kamana, ichha, kamana, karma, and then the raga, dvesha, sanskara, again kamana, again karma. So this chakra or the sansara chakra continues, and the results also are worldly, sansara phala. So that is our karma. But when we start doing karma yoga, it's a very different attitude. According to Krishna, Shri Krishna, nishkam karma, selfless action, does not bind us. When we do something without any expectation of anything in return, not even a praise, not even anything in return, and this kind of nishkam karma, done with an Ishwararpana bhava, as if we are trying to please the Lord, all our duties, all our actions are done with that perspective. It is one of the attitudes of karma yoga. And this leads us to ultimately the purification, antakarana shuddhi, and with this the jnana, atma jnana, which can relieve the ajnana, which is the root cause of all our miseries, sorrows. And this can lead us to mukti or moksha or liberation, freedom from all the worldly afflictions. So the two lifestyle approaches that Lord Shri Krishna talks about here is based on our adhikaritva. Adhikaritva means our suitability, whether we are fit, what kind of inclination we have. It is not, adhikaritva doesn't mean that this is my right. It is like more like my inclination or more like my duty. And here again, our Guruji says that the karma yoga is the preferred path for most people because it is a safe path. The karma yoga is because most of us are action oriented people, and that's why karma yoga is a safe and the preferred path. Though jnana yoga is a very pious path because it liberates us from all our undoings, karma, everything gets liberated, burnt, everything. And that's the ultimate goal, yes, but the way to this goal is through karma yoga because it's a preferred path. And the other way we can describe this is there are two different lifestyle approaches. One is a gruhastha pravritti marga, that is a gruhastha marg, which is of course a safe marg. The other is the path of renunciation of the sannyas, which is which can be dangerous, if especially when somebody has taken a sannyasa at a very premature or a immature level. Because ultimately, after taking sannyasa, our person's goal must be to obtain atma jnana. So even the sannyasis have to go through the same sadhana, karma yoga or jnana yoga. But there, because they are not householders, they don't have to do the karma yoga sadhana, they have to do more of a jnana yoga sadhana. And the gruhastha, for him, the karma yoga pravritti marg, the karma marg, and the nivritti marg is for the sannyasis. So these are the two lifestyle approaches that Shri Krishna has described. For most of the people, karma yoga is a preferred path, the gruhastha is a safe path, the pravritti marg, the karma marg, is the best path to obtain salvation in this world itself, in this life itself. By doing the same work with a different attitude, we can obtain salvation. That is the biggest solace that Lord Shri Krishna gives to all of us. So here, how we can again understand that karma yoga also includes the bhakti yoga. Here, Lord Krishna talks about two approaches, karma and jnana. He does not talk about bhakti yoga. Whereas in Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam, there are three approaches that have been described, and bhakti is a separately described approach. Whereas here, in Sri Bhagavad Gita, Karma, when Lord Krishna says karma, karma includes bhakti. Bhakti is an integral part of karma yoga. Without bhakti, one cannot have karma yoga. Because in karma yoga, we have to accept Ishvara. There is a role of Ishvara in our life. Ishvara is, has given us so much to begin with. And we do our actions, our karma, to please the Lord, to repay that debt that Lord has given us, whatever. According to his Agnya, we do it as a servant, that this is the order of the Lord. This is with an Ishvara Arpana Bhava, surrender buddhi, with the Prasada buddhi, whatever he is giving us, we accept it and share it with everyone. So all these are integral parts of Karma Yoga, and this would not happen without having Ishvara, God, as a central part with us all the time. And that's why Karma Yoga, when we say Karma Yoga, there is bhakti always there, and it is the first step, the prarambhik sadhana. The first step is the adhikaritva, to obtain the atmajnana, and this adhikaritva is the first step, is the antakarana shuddhi. And this antakarana shuddhi also happens with sadhana chatushtaya sampatti. This is the sadhana, the vivek, vairagya, shama, adi, shat sampatti and mumuksha. All these are important, because we have to remove all these impurities of our mind, like the raga, dvesha, kama, krodha, madha, matsarya. All these impurities have to go away, and the atma antakarana becomes shuddha and becomes eligible patra to hold this atma jnana, which will only come when our inner mind is pure. After that, the next step of the sadhana is the jnana yoga sadhana, and the jnana yoga sadhana, essentially we have to go to a guru and listen to Vedanta Shravana, Vedanta Vakya from Guru Mukha. Then Manana, that means we have to remove all our doubts by Yukti, logic, and Nididhyasana, contemplation and assimilation, integralization of these Atma Jnana. And then we can, relieve this Ajnana by this Jnana of our own self, Atma Jnana. So that is the final step, and that is the Antim Sadhana, to obtain this self-knowledge. So this is the entire journey of this spiritual journey.
Na karmanam narambha naishkarmyam purushoshnute na cha sanyasana deva siddhim samadigachati.
So in this fourth shloka, Shri Krishna says, he says clearly no to renouncing of actions. Karma tyaga of any type is not ordered in our scriptures. So Upanishads, Vedas, they never order. Sannyasa is never an agya. Sannyasa is only a kind of a, it's a permission at a particular and an appropriate stage that one can obtain this sannyasa. So here he says, na karmana manarambhat naishkaramya purusha atna aushnute, means just by renouncing the actions, by doing karma tyaga, either somebody is lazy, doesn't want to work, he says, no, I don't want to work, just he renounces action, karma tyaga. Other way is, a person cannot achieve liberation. So, being in akarma, actionlessness, being renouncing the actions, or just avoiding, delaying the actions, what is need to be done, we need to do it. If we just kind of delay the actions, procrastinate, though this is not the attitude of karma yoga. So we need to do what needs to be done, what is our duty must be done, and that is the only way we can achieve, go ahead on this path. Nacha sanyasanasat eva siddhin samadhikachati, and by renouncing the world, by taking sannyasa alone, one cannot achieve liberation. So here Lord Krishna says that renouncing the action in any form, either by renouncing the actions and being without in actionlessness, or renouncing the world and being a sannyasi, by itself does not lead to moksha. This is very clear to understand that, sannyasis who have taken sannyasa or who have renounced the world, they also have to go through the jnana sadhana. The same is true for the gruhasthas, those who are in this world. For them also, this sadhana is the same. They have to go through the karma yoga sadhana, jnana yoga sadhana, and then they have to go to the moksha. So the karma marga is the safe marga, it is the preferred marga according to Shri Krishna, the pravritti marga, the gruhastha marga, And the Karma Yoga Marga is a safe mark for spiritual upliftment, for improvement and going ahead on this path. In the fourth sloka, Lord Krishna says, renouncing action does not lead to karma. We already saw that. Karma Tyaga or Sannyasa does not lead to moksha. One has to do the sadhana, what is needed. The Karma Yoga is important for Antakarana Shuddhi and Jnana Sadhana for Jnana, for self-knowledge. In the fifth sloka, he says, complete renunciation of action is almost impossible for any one of us. Because for everything, for every small thing, we have to go into action. Suppose we want to eat, we want to drink, we want to go to bed, we want to sleep, we want to, you know, brush our teeth, whatever. All simple karmas for anything that we materially do in our life, karma is important. We cannot completely renunciate action. That is impossible. And then in the sixth sloka, he says, immature renunciation of action is dangerous because it can produce counterproductive results. And that's why immature renunciation is not advisable. And that's why what Lord Krishna is trying to tell us is that the best thing for you is to do karma yoga with the right attitude and change your karma into karma yoga. Karma yoga is the best and the safest method for upliftment. Do your actions in the best possible way. And what is that? We'll come to that in this adhyaya. And leave, don't be attached to the fruits of the action. Karmanye vadhikaraste, because karma mehi hamara adhikar hai, to choose the karma, to decide whether to do or not to do, what is the way to do, how to do it, understand all the, you know, the other aspects of the karma, what we are going to do, what are the likely outcomes, evaluate all the possible, you know, eventualities. And then when we start doing it, our focus must be on the karma, not on the karma phala. Our focus must be on the karma, because this is the area that we can make a material difference. This is the area which is within our control. The karma phala is not within our control, and that's why our focus must be there. We should not be attached. We should not be insistent on a particular result or an outcome. We should not have an obsession for a particular result or an outcome, but we should just be unattached to the results of the outcome and just do our work in the best possible way. And this is also an attitude of karma yoga.
Nahi kaschit shanam api jato tishtatya karma krita karyate avashah karma sarva prakruti jair gunaihi.
So in this shloka, Shri Krishna says it is impossible to remain without karma even for a moment, because all our life is all involved in some or the other karma. Without doubt, without performing action, no one can survive even for a moment, he says. And he says, sarva prakruti jair gunaihi karyate hi avashak karma. Means the three gunas of the prakruti. You know that in this world, we are all having these three gunas of the prakruti, the sattva, the rajasa and the tamasa. And this will literally force the person, because we are all made up of this prakruti. And this nature or this prakruti will force actually our person and make him helpless. Avashaha, he will be forced to do action. And we may even not understand how we keep doing our actions. And depending on the mixture of these three gunas, people employ in different kinds of actions. The person who is more in sattva, who has preponderant sattva guna and less of raja and tama, he will do, you know, more sattvika actions. A person who is more rajo guna, born out of more action-oriented, ego-generated, you know, wants to achieve our success, rajogun, pradhanya, and less of sattva and less of tamas, he will be into worldly affairs, wants to achieve in the world. Somebody who is more in tamasa guna, preponderance, and less of sattva, rajas, will be more of, you know, happy-go-lucky type, laid down, bad, you know, lazy type of attitude, is not an achiever, is okay with life, it goes along in life. So these are the different attitudes or gunas through which we operate, and our nature operates from this perspective. So Shri Krishna says here, these are the three gunas of the prakriti or the nature, which will actually force us and we are helpless. And here we need to understand that how we work, you know, the raga, dvesha are the main initiators of action, because these sanskaras are the impressions in our mind. And every time we work, these sanskaras are there as impressions, and they work in a very subtle way. We don't even understand how they work. And raga essentially is going towards or attraction to our liking, of of the object or the person or the situation or the relationship or whatever, and that forces us to do that, keep on doing that again and again. Dvesha is something that we don't like. Say for some food we don't like, then we have a dvesha. We don't like to have it. If it comes in front of us, we get worried or afraid, or we get violent sometimes, or we express displeasure. So dvesha is going away, or repulsion. So this is how raga dvesha work, and the only way to nullify these raga dvesha is the attitude of karma yoga, the samatva bhavana. With this samatva bhavana, with this prasada buddhi, if we work, then we don't, you know, activate our raga dvesha. We accept whatever is given as an offering from the Lord with the samatva buddhi rising above. When Lord Krishna says nirdvandva bhava, don't, you know, dvandva, these dualities of mind, let it not affect you too much. Tantitikshasva bharata, endure this realities, dualities of the world. So these are all the attitudes. If we imbibe, then we can actually, you know, become much more stable, much more balanced in our life. You know, whenever there is a success, we don't get elated. When there is a, you know, failure, we don't get depressed. So this kind of dualities will less affect us. And this is what is called as the nullification or the annihilation of the raga dvesha, which are the root cause of the problems in us when we operate. So karma yoga is this tool which will help us to nullify these raga dvesha. In the sixth shloka, Shri Krishna says, Karmendriyani sayamya yaaste manasa smaran indriyathan vimudhatma mithyachara sa ujyate. So here he shows what will happen if somebody takes a immature renunciation. He renounces his physical action, but he is not that matured. His, you know, mind is not that matured. And that's why what happens is that karmendriyani sanyamya yaaste manasa smaran, means he's controlled his sense organs of action. Karmendriya, you know, he is sitting somewhere, he says, I don't want to work. He's sitting down somewhere, but he doesn't have that control of his mind. And that's why manasa smaran indriyan, that means he continues thinking about the sense objects in his mind. Constantly there is a thought. So he's sitting somewhere, he's trying to say that, okay, let me do meditation, but when he closes his eyes, there are lots of thoughts coming in his mind, because that mind maturity is not there. He is the biggest fool, he says. Vimudhatma. Mudha means fool, and Vimudhatma means he's one of the biggest fool, and he is also mithyachara sa uchyate. He's a hypocrite, because he is not a true karma yogi. That's what he says. Shri Krishna says, according to Shri Krishna, you know, just renouncing action from outside is not karma yoga. Because one may renounce action from outside and one say that, no, I've done enough work, I don't want to work more, I just want to sit at home, relax, enjoy. But at home is constantly thinking about the work, because, you know, mind is still there, it is still involved. That mind, maturity of the mind has not happened. And when you continue to do this kind of karma in our mind, manasik karma, constantly thoughts about karma, that is also karma. And that means that we are attached to that karma. And when we are attached to that karma and we leave the karma from outside, that person is a hypocrite. That person is not a simple man, because he thinks something, he speaks something, he does something. There is a discordance of his activities. So that is what Shri Krishna says here. He is a hypocrite. He is the biggest fool. And this is what Shri Krishna says. We should avoid this kind of mithyachara, dambha, hypocrisy. Be aware. Simplicity is very important. Simplicity essentially means that whatever we think, we should speak, and whatever we speak, we should do. You know, this is the simplicity of mana, vachana, karma, vyavara. A susangata or oneness in all the three is simplicity. And that is what Arjuna is known for, because his name itself signifies Rujutvat Arjuna, simplicity. And these are the only people who are simple, they will achieve the peace of mind. People who think different, they speak something different and do something different are the ones who never achieve peace of mind. Because they are always there focusing on what they have to remember, what they have spoken, what they have thought, and there is no discordance in all this. Also, Shri Krishna tries to tell us that we should not be a showman. There are people who will show their work, try to show that they are doing too much. They are showmen, you know, they will speak something more than what they have done, and this signifies our pride, our ego, It's a false sense of our security, our identification with our body-mind complex, and trying to, you know, shield ourselves and trying to glorify ourselves. So this kind of showmanship also does not help us on this path. In this path, honesty and simplicity is what helps us. We should also keep our life simple, asking the right questions whenever we meet a learned guru. Think right, have a right understanding about karma yoga, about action, about the results of the action, and accept the responsibility for the change. Because on this path, it is very important that karma is the only our area of free will. This is where we can make a difference. And that's why whatever difference we can make is within our own self, in our own mind, in our own thoughts, and in our own actions. Most of the times what happens is, for my miseries or my sorrows, most of the times we try to blame others. It's because of you that I got this. Because you said something, I had this. Because you did something, I had a problem. So we try to blame others for our own sorrows, miseries. This is a normal, natural tendency. But Vedanta tells us very clearly that our miseries and our sorrows are because of our own ignorance. And this is where we have to work on. So where we have to work is within our own self. We don't have to work outside. We don't have to change anyone outside. But when we change anything inside, which is even difficult, but when we try to do that, and gradually when we see that something inside us is changing, we will also, with this understanding, and this only happens with understanding, and with this understanding, when things start changing inside us, we will also see the change outside. So that change outside which we will see is not the change that we have made outside, but what we have made inside, what we now can see, because our vision will change, and that's why we will see a different world. So this is the entire process, how the change happens. And this is what, there are very famous statements, even one of them, Mahatma Gandhi said, be the change that you want to see outside. Essentially means the same, that we have to change our own self to see any change outside, essentially. So we should try avoid blaming others for our problems, try to accept the responsibility, do karma yoga, surrender to the Lord, accept the results, whatever, do our best. So in the seventh shloka, Shri Krishna says, Yastvindriyani manasa niyamyarabhate arjuna karmendriyai karma yogam asakta sabishishyate. So here he tells us what actually we need to do. Now he comes to what we need to do as a karma yoga, and he praises the control of the senses, the indriya sanyama, and asakta, unattached karma. So he says, oh Arjuna, what you need to do is, the one who controls his sense organs with his mind, he does indriya sanyam, yaha indriyani manasa niyamyaha. So with some kind of a sanyama, he controls his sense organs and his mind, with his mind, and starts performing the actions of karma yoga with all the sense organs. So he does indriya sanyam and does karma yoga with a detachment, with a kind of non-attachment to the results. And that person is a unique person, because he is not attached to the results. And that's what is the grand vision of karma yoga, as Shri Krishna wants us to understand. So in this shloka, he tells about two things. One is that we should have a control over our senses, that is indriya sanyam, that is also with the mana sanyama. And two, we should, all our karmendriyas must be involved in karma yoga, but without an attachment to the results of the action. So that is what he wants us. These are the two things that Shri Krishna tells us to do, and that is the path of the karma yoga.
So indriya sanyam, or sense control, is an important aspect of karma yoga, because our indriyas, our sense organs, are bahirmukha. Bahirmukha means that their natural tendency is to go outwardly. And the other issue is that they are very chanchala. Chanchala means they are very, very active. They are super active. The moment, we are trying to concentrate something and there is a small noise, our sense will go there, our organ sense will go towards that object. There is any disturbance anywhere else, we'll try to open our eyes and see what is happening. So indriya are very, very chanchala, and that's why
the natural tendency of Indriya is to go out towards the Vishaya or the objects from which it feels that it derives some pleasure, it's a food for this Indriya. And on this Indriya, there is a control of the Mana. So Mana controls the Indriya, and Mana is controlled by the Buddhi. And Buddhi, over this, of course, our consciousness, our Atma has a control over this, can control this. So essentially, Mana is at the center. And Mana can either, along with Indriya, as in the second Adhyaya, Shri Krishna said, Indriya, Indriyani Pramathini Harante Prasabham Mana. Means it will hara the Mana. It is so powerful. Indriya is very powerful. The sense organ is so powerful that it will pull the Mana towards outwardly. But if the Buddhi becomes more stronger, then it can actually pull the Mana inside inwardly, and it can stabilize the mind. So the mind control is the most important control. Indriya Sanyama is called the Dama, and Mana control, Mana Sanyama, is called the Shama. It is a Shama which is the first one which is important, and then through Shama we can have Dama. So Shama, Dama, in the Shama Adi Shat Sampatti, the Shama and the Dama are the most important. So that is what Shri Krishna is talking here about. And this mind control or Shama, how can we achieve this? It is so important because the entire spiritual journey is just to discipline our mind, because this is the most important asset for us, for all of us, the seekers, because it is only through this mind that we have to, to relieve all our impurities, to transcend ourselves, to understand this knowledge, to concentrate, to focus, to learn new things, to understand concepts, to clarify them. All these only happen through the mind. So though mind cannot perceive this, the highest self, the Atma Tattva, but it's only through this mind and this body that we are able to achieve this or to reach this. So it sounds like a paradox, but it is a reality. So only through this we can transcend and we can achieve that. And that's why the maturity of the mind is very important, and this disciplining of the mind is the spiritual journey. In contrast, the body, it matures as the age grows. There are all the changes that happen in the body. In the teenage, there is the reproductive organs, and there is maturity, and then there is as we become an adult, all the other features happen in the body. So body matures naturally, but the mind does not mature normally. It needs to be matured. Understanding somehow, sometimes even in adults, we see that they behave like a child. They have so much of jid, insistence, so much of duragra, so much of obsession, so much of stubborn attitude. We see in so many adults every day. It's like a child, even at the age of 80 years or 90 years, people behave like a child. That they're like a stubborn attitude. No, this must be done in this way. They're not at all flexible. So this maturity of the mind is something that needs a lot of time, efforts, understanding. And initially this sanyama or this control or this niyamya or sanyam, sometimes initially it has to be under, suppression, but it cannot be suppressed for a period of time, because then it'll spring, it'll, come back with its double force. But constantly with understanding, with awareness, if we clearly keep on doing along with our man, wherever the indriyas are going, sense organs, we are aware about it, we try to bring it back like a turtle, how it withdraws all its limbs, and then param drashtva nivartate, put it in the feet of the Lord Almighty. So this is how we can control our sense organs, our indriya, through our mind. And this is what Shri Krishna teaches us in Sri Bhagavad Gita, how to achieve this indriya sanyama, mana sanyama. And gradually when we practice this, keep on practicing this, this becomes kind of a sahaj, it becomes habit. Then the habits change, but it takes a lot of time, energy to change this kind of habits, because it's so automatic. It's almost like instantaneously, the moment we see something, those raga dveshas will become active. We are forced to do something, some action or some karma, some vachana, some vani. So this is so automatic, it is so habitual, that we have to first be aware and then gradually change these habits. So again, coming to Karma Yoga, it's one of the best methods for our inner purification, our raga, dvesha, shithilikaran, annihilation. It's like a broad spectrum antibiotic because it kills many of our bad habits. Kama, Krodha, Mada, Moha, Matsarya, Raga, Dvesha, all these doshas that we have in our mind, Durguna. Because unless these gets cleared, we cannot imbibe this Atma Jnana. It is not possible. And the Karma Yoga starts that first from Akarma, we have to get into the Karma mode. The next shloka, Lord Krishna is going to talk about this, how Karma is better than Akarma. But then Dharma Karma, Kartavya Karma is important because we have to do it right with the right attitude, with the right duty, with the righteousness, keeping the Dharma in mind, what is good for everyone, and like a Kartavya Karma. So, while in action, Ishwarapana Bhava, Samarpana Bhava, we should not compromise. Samarpana Bhava does not mean that we compromise with our life principles. We must have ethicality, integrity, morality as some of the very, very important principles in our life, and we should not compromise on these principles. But at the same time, whatever is the karma phala, we should accept them completely as Lord has given us some kind of a prasada. We have to swikar with the acceptance of these, because most of the times only when we try to reject this, we don't accept this, there is a denial to any of the situation that happened in our life, maybe some immature death of one of our close relatives, we are always in a mode of denial, and that's why we are not able to accept it, and that's the problem that creates a lot of stress, tension, anxieties in us. Acceptance is one of the most important principles for our own peace of mind, and more the acceptance, more will be our peace of mind. We will remain in the peace, and peace of mind should be our highest prerogative. Our highest priority must be given to our own peace of mind rather than any other worldly possessions that we have. And if this is, then we can make use of our karma to liberate ourselves from this karma bondage. And basically, with the attitude, we should do our best in action and be prepared for the worst result, or for whatever is the result, we should be prepared for it. If the result is not up to our expectation, we should actually inquire, look into detail, see how we can improve, do a course correction and continue on that path. And if again, the desired result is not obtained, if it is much less than what we have expected, or it is, counterproductive results or something completely different, instead of profit we were expecting from a business venture, we go into loss, then we will try to think and do a course correction, evaluate the factors. But if we still continue to, then we may think that, okay, God is not willing for me to continue this, maybe I should change, maybe I should close down. And this is the right understanding with which we should all work. And we should be prepared for any result, any eventuality, because eventually we must accept that the result of the action that I am going to do is not within my control. It is not my jurisdiction. It is not my prerogative. It is not my, area of my field of my control. So that is, control is somewhere else. Maybe Lord, with His own big, grand, cosmic design, is controlling this for everyone. And His system of justice is a very fair system of justice. So whatever I am getting it's a very fair share, which I must accept as a Lord's offering, as a prasada bhakti. The benefits of Karma Yoga: it can help us to change our mindset from more of a scarcity to an abundance mindset, because we are not just thinking of our own self, we are thinking of a lot of people around, first the family members, then our extended family, then the society at large, for the humanity, and for all the creatures in this world. So from being more and more selfish, we become more and more selfless. We work with a lot of happiness and joy, because we are now focused in our action, and that is what gives us the joy. Not just the result, what is going to be, we are going to get in the future, is going to get us joy, but the joy is in the work itself. So this is one of the attitudes of Karma Yoga, and this helps us to maintain a rhythm and balance in life, because we think of our needs rather than our greeds, and then we do whatever is necessary, we inquire, we think about what we are doing, and this helps us to maintain a balance between our work and our life, our family life. It creates a rhythm in our life, it creates a routine, a discipline in our life, brings a discipline in our life, and that ultimately gives us a lot of satisfaction, santosha, because it is only in santosha that we can get happiness or peace of mind. Just by achieving worldly pleasures, outer pleasures, money, wealth, fame, name, all these alone does not give us the ultimate satisfaction or the peace of mind. If this is our goal, then Karma Yoga is the best path. If just the material possessions is our goal, then going out and enjoying and doing it in the world is the best path for us. So we have to decide what we essentially finally want in our life, what do we need, what is our expectations, what our priorities, and accordingly we should act. So raga dvesha are, again Lord Krishna says, they are root cause of the problem. Raga is a sukha vritti, that this object or this person should remain constantly with me because I like that person and should remain with me, and then this creates a kamana, and then I always want that that person or that object be with me and is with me. So this produces kind of a lobha vritti to get more and more and more. Dvesha on the other hand is dukkha vritti, that this object or this person should remain away from me because I don't like this person or this object, and if that person or that object comes in front of me, I develop some anger sometimes, and something that I don't like comes in front of me, then I become sometimes even violent. So these are all the impurities start from the raga dvesha, which are working in our mind in a very, very dormant state, and they get activated when the indriya senses them and they create the impressions in our mind. So this is how the raga dvesha work, and this is how the jnani, for a jnani, is his mind is like a mirror. It's like it just sees a clear impression. There is no raga dvesha, there are no these sanskaras, because these raga dveshas are all nullified through this practice of karma yoga, and that's why those new impressions are not created, which force him to do what he does not like to want to do, or what is not, his mind is very, very kind of balanced, equipoised, samatva is what he has obtained, and that's why these impressions are not there. So indriya sanyam is a very important part of training, sadhana. From raga vritti, dvesha vritti, we should go to upeksha vritti, which helps us to achieve this samatva bhavana. And Bhagavad Gita is like an allegory to a chariot, where indriyas are the horses which are going out into, and they are all running outside. Mana is like a lagam, it's the the way to control these horses, and buddhi is like a sarthi. And in Shri Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna, none other than Shri Krishna, is the buddhi or sarthi. And this sanyama, indriya sanyama, through the mana sanyama, is the true success in life, and this is one of the essential ingredients of karma yoga, which has been described here. So to summarize the first 7 verses, Arjuna's question whether karma or knowledge, Lord shows him 2 paths, karma yoga and jnana yoga nishtha. These are the 2 nishthas, both of them lead to jnana nishtha. And the jnana sadhana and the karma yoga sadhana, both are essential part of us. And in the 4th, 5th and 6th adhyayas, he says karma tyaga is not possible, and immature karma tyaga is dangerous. And he stresses 2 important things in the 7th shloka, the indriya sanyama, which is so important through mana sanyama, shama and dama, and anasakti, the non-attachment to the results of the action. So in karma, we should have sanyama, in action, in karma phala, we should have anasakti, loss of attachment. And then the next session, we are going to discuss these 4 attitudes of karma yoga that Lord Krishna talks about. Niyatam kuru karmatvam, do it as your duty. That is the first attitude, attitude of duty, attitude of repaying your debt to this universe. And then finally, 4 other attitudes, where attitude of yagna buddhi, how we can do our work like we are doing a yagna or an offering to the Lord. It's Ishwararpana bhavana. Prasada buddhi, when we get the results, how we can accept it like a prasada buddhi. And dharma buddhi talks about the srushti chakra, how it goes on and how we can be part of this. And if somebody is not a part of this, then what is what kind of person that person is. So these are the topics for the next session on karma yoga, the different attitudes. The next 8 shlokas tells us about these 4 important attitudes of karma yoga and how we can apply this in our life. Thank you very much. We will end with a Guru Prarthana. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.